I was living in a small house in West Long Branch, New Jersey, up the coast from Asbury. One day I was playing my guitar on the edge of the bed, working on some song ideas, and the words Born to Run came to me. At first I thought it was the name of a movie or something I'd seen on a car spinning around the circuit. I liked the phrase because it suggested a cinematic drama that I thought would work with the music that I'd been hearing in my head.
It was the third studio album from Bruce Springsteen. Legend has it that when he heard the final mix of the title track and the album, he was so disgusted after 14 months of recording, he threw the tape into a hotel pool. His first two albums were commercial flops, but this one, Born to Run, had a lot of underground sizzle before the vinyl hit. August 25th, 1975, 40 minutes of music hit the airwaves. Bruce Springsteen's life and rock and roll would never be the same again. Let's welcome back the pop music critic for the Cleveland Plain Dealer, a drummer and rocker in his own right who knows that rock history, Chuck Yarborough. Chuck, pleasure to talk to you again. And when we look at this, when we just look at Born to Run, look, I'm a fan. I'm going to say that right out front. I think it's one of the greatest rock and roll albums ever made. It was a turning point in so many ways. But from the critic's standpoint, what is it about this album that was so special?
The poetry. I mean, if you look at some of the lyrics on there, I mean, that's when we actually finally got away from, you know, the DCDG, you know, whatever, the chord progression thing. We actually listened to what somebody was saying. If you look at one of my favorite songs on this thing is 10th Avenue Freeze Out. Read the lyrics on that sometimes. It makes like Lou Reed look like an optimist.
Is that just sometimes what we miss in the early Springsteen, but even in today? The songwriting, if you go back, if you just read them, there is meaning to it, there's heart to it, there's grit to it. I mean, when you think of all the music that he has done, and then to think of what started there. Look, you mentioned 10th Avenue Freeze Out. Let's talk about Born to Run itself. Let's talk about Badlands that came later. Let's talk about all these other songs in here. There's a story there that works, yes?
There is. He's kind of like our own Tom Joad. Not to be surprising, since he did that whole thing. But he is the guy from the Grapes of Wrath.
But then what about what he did to make this special? Let's just talk about, because very few people know this, there was something called the Wall of Sound that Phil Spector had worked with for many years. And this was an album that was put together in really a ratty studio. And it wasn't until they actually got it to a better studio in New York. Look, the people at his own label didn't really like this album, yes?
Oh, that's true. I mean, very few people. There was, you mentioned it earlier, there was talk that had this album not succeeded, he was going to be dropped by the label. He's told the guys in the band, don't worry, because we got nothing else to do. We were born to run.
So then how do we look at this album overall in context of 1975? It certainly changed Springsteen's career, launched it in many ways, and then led us to Born in the USA, which became the commercial success. But what effect did it have on rock and roll in general?
An amazing effect, because remember, the thing about rock and roll is that it captures the image of the time. It's a snapshot of the times. And this, he wrote it in 74, came out in 75. So this is right after the end of the Vietnam War. There's factories closing. There's all these kind of economic downturns like, oh, wow, that sort of sounds familiar, but that's a different subject. He really put the 70s in perspective and also got rid of things that were kind of running the news, the music business right then. With Donny Osmond was hot then, the Bee Gees were hot then, the Carpenters were hot then. They actually put rock and roll back on the map as rock and roll.
How does he then, I mean, look, his concerts are some of the greatest times you'll ever spend. It's 3 hours of, it's a family, it's an environment now. It's everybody knows everybody. You see people who travel to concerts, they do dozens of them every year. It's great fun. But the guy is in his 60s now. How does he manage to still keep it as fresh as ever?
You know, rock and roll artists have told me the same thing every time I ask them that same question. You're doing the same songs you've been doing for 20 years. How do you keep it fresh? They tell me, the audiences kind of bring it back alive for me. Every time I do it, I've got to remember that it may be the first time they've heard it live. So I've got to bring it every time. And Bruce is absolutely fantastic at that.
Is there anybody close to Springsteen right now from the writing, the studio, and the performance live level?
Okay, I may surprise you with this. Zac Brown.
That's surprising, but then again, Zac Brown's newest album is a little bit of a takeoff where they're doing a lot of different genres in that album right now, not just country. That's interesting. Why?
Well, because of the same thing. The writing there is really good, but because it's also outstanding musicianship. That may be the best pure band out there. and his ability and willingness to stretch himself the same way that Bruce did back in those days. I mean, he's did, on this particular album you just mentioned, he's got Sarah Bareilles, he's got Chris Cornell, he's worked with Dave Grohl. He's not putting himself in one special little area. He said, this is music, and I don't really care what you call it.
I got about 15 seconds left. Fair to say that Springsteen is a guy who those people of a certain generation in their 50s and 60s, they look back lovingly, but there's 20-year-olds who love his music. Spans generations.
It does, absolutely. My band, my cover band, plays a lot of his songs, and we get kids from who are just not barely old enough to get into the bars to guys in walkers who are dancing.
They're just awesome. From Thunder Road to Backstreets to She's the One, what a great album in 40 years. My God. Chuck Yarborough from the Cleveland Plain Dealer, always a pleasure, Chuck. Thanks so much for
joining
us.
Thanks, sir. I appreciate it.
Coming back next with Telling It Like It Is and a proper prep for the new football season.